We're back. Thank you all. Again, good evening. My name is Sean Moriarty. I'm Deputy Commissioner of New Jersey Department of Environmental Protection. I'll be the hearing officer for this public hearing. The hearing is being held to receive oral and written comments on the proposed environmental justice rulemaking, which implements the environmental justice law. In September of 2020, Governor Murphy signed New Jersey's landmark environmental justice law, the first of its kind and the nation's most empowering environmental justice legislation. The environmental justice law recognizes that because environmental standards are often formulated based on the effect pollution has upon general populations spread over wide geographic areas, existing environmental laws may fail to fully consider the impacts that certain pollution-generating facilities have on their local communities, and that this failure has created pockets of high pollution across New Jersey, where many pollution-generating facilities have become concentrated in predominantly minority and low-income communities that may lack the financial and political power to shape their local landscape and avoid disproportionate adverse impacts upon their public health and environment. At its most basic, the law requires us to consider whether a specific facility seeking a specific type of permit will contribute to environmental or public health stressors in an overburdened community, considering whether and how those stressors might have a disproportionate impact when compared to the overburdened community's neighbors, a comparative analysis. The law requires the department to assess relevant environmental and public health stressors affecting New Jersey's overburdened communities and to deny or condition permits for certain facilities that cannot avoid causing or contributing to adverse environmental or public health stressors in that community. The law applies where three criteria are met. First, if the facility is located or proposed to be located in an overburdened community. Second, the proposed or existing facility is one of the eight types of facilities listed in the Act. Those include major sources of air pollution, as well as many types of solid waste facilities. Third, the applicant seeks a type of permit from the department or approval covered by the Act. Where the environmental justice law applies, an applicant must submit an environmental justice impact statement, or EJIS, to the department evaluating how the proposed action, whether a new facility or the renewal of a major source of air pollution or the expansion of an existing facility, would contribute to environmental or public health stressors in its host community. The EJIS must also address how the applicant proposes to avoid, and where avoidance is not feasible, minimize such impacts, and under certain circumstances, provide a net environmental or public health benefit to the overburdened community. The EJIS is made available to the public in advance of a public hearing. To ensure meaningful public participation of the members of the overburdened community, an applicant is required to hold a public hearing in the overburdened community to present the proposed project and the environmental justice impact statement. That includes a public comment period of at least 60 days to provide an opportunity for feedback from those most impacted by the proposed project. Notice and materials will be made available in languages accessible to community members, and the applicant will be required to address all comments received during the public process. Upon conclusion, the department would evaluate the EJIS and the information presented at the public hearing and through public comment to determine whether additional environmental or public health stressors, whether the additions to environmental or public health stressors expected from the actions in the permit application would, together with the baseline of stressors already impacting the community, cause or contribute to adverse cumulative environmental or public health stressors in that overburdened community that are higher than those of non-overburdened communities in the state. If that is the case, a disproportionate impact will be present, and the department may deny the permit or approve it with conditions that avoid or minimize those impacts. On June 6, 2022, the department proposed rules in the New Jersey Register to implement the environmental justice law. The public comment period for that proposal closes on September 4th, 2022, and as indicated in the public notice, written comments can be submitted electronically to www.nj.gov/dep/comments or provided to Melissa Beta Marco at the address provided in the notice. All relevant comments received during the public comment period will be addressed in the New Jersey Register should the department adopt the proposed rule. The public hearing on the proposed rule is being held in accordance with the Administrative Procedures Act, and as required, the department has provided additional notice of this public hearing through the department's website, through electronic mail, and through written communication with a number of news outlets. The goal of today's hearing is to receive verbal comments into the record concerning this rule proposal. This hearing is not intended to be a question and answer session, but rather an opportunity for interested individuals to voice their concerns and suggestions regarding this rulemaking. If you've not already done so, we'd ask you to sign the attendance sheet and indicate whether you're interested in speaking at tonight's hearing. We would begin by listing the individuals who have asked for an opportunity to speak and ask them to identify themselves as they step to the microphone, spell their names, and identify any organization that they might be representing. We're asking folks to limit their comments to 3 minutes. If there is additional time at the end after all who've signed up have spoken, we would provide additional opportunities for folks. This is now the second of the 5 public hearings we will be holding on this rulemaking. There will be hearings in Camden, as well as Newark, as well as a virtual hearing in several weeks. Right now, I do not have a list of anyone who's indicated they'd like to speak. So if anyone would like to step up to the microphone and offer comments, we'll ask you to. Otherwise, we will keep the record open until 7 o'clock tonight, and then we will conclude this portion of the public hearing. At the first session today, we did translate that opening statement into Spanish. I would just like to ask if there's anyone in the audience who feels they would benefit from that translation right now. If so, we will do it. Otherwise, we will hold the time open for folks to speak. If anyone would like it translated, please raise your hand. Okay. So at this point, I'm going to stop talking. Anybody who wishes to speak, please step up. Otherwise, we will be here until 7 o'clock. And thank you all for your interest.
Is on?
Yes. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Robert Davis. Let me spell it. Robert Davis. Good evening, everyone. I'm a member of local IUOE Local 825. I represent heavy equipment operators in the construction industry. Like many of my fellow union brothers and sisters, I'm aware of the environment and the way to protect it. The concern that I have is that the regulations do not take into consideration the construction industry and workers like myself. These regulations will put a stop to projects that are vital to our communities, including water, sewage, school, and low-income housing. As members of the construction industry, we feel this process has been one-sided. We ask that you keep in mind construction and workers like myself and the members that I represent, as well as the economic developments of our communities. Thank you.
Thank you,
sir. Hey, good afternoon. My name is Kristen Dasso. Kristen Dasso, they, them pronouns. I live my teenage and young adult years in the community of Irvington and now currently reside in Jersey City, both of which are environmental justice communities. I work as a community connections program manager at the New Jersey Environmental Justice Alliance and hold a master's in environmental policy and sustainability management. Growing up, passing by toxic sites and facilities, seeing smokestacks and endless truck traffic was and is part of the everyday experience for those of us living in these communities. As I've gotten older and recognized that the links between our communities, health, and racial discrimination of Black and brown people and the siting of polluting facilities. The thought of more facilities like these feel like a punch to the communities that are already struggling. And the EJ law provides the tools to protect EJ communities from more pollution. Within the law, I want to ask if the following are insured. On background, it's vital that overburdened communities are defined using 3 criteria: having limited English proficiency, living in low-income areas, or being a minority. As each criteria protects different vulnerable communities in New Jersey, and the criteria doesn't always overlap. On meaningful public participation, the burden our communities experiences gives us little time to be engaged in something that isn't working for our survival. The process for us to engage and participate should be accessible. This means increasing the number of meetings held more than just one meeting, providing the opportunity to submit comments in virtual mediums, such as oral recordings, videos, and digital or visual comments. Sometimes communities don't have the time or to write up any comments and submit them. For the notices, nowadays people have different ways in which we become aware of what's happening in our communities. So in addition to the municipal clerk, newspapers, and governing bodies, the EP should include legacy groups rooted in EJ and its online EJ corner. The applicants are required to notify. It will help build relationships between community and industry. DEP should also ensure that notices are made to approve newspapers by region. For example, Essex News Daily is a great place for a good community input from a single county. However, nowadays, fewer people read newspapers and most people are engaged in online or in community networks. DEP has to require more modern forms of notifications for people to be updated and aware. The tech and knowledge are available. Additionally, notifications should be sent out to the county where the facility application is taking place, as opposed to just the 200 feet radius. The impact of pollution does not stay contained within those 200 feet, especially given how large the size of the impact area is for any given facility. And I just want to make a quick comment on compelling public interest. Please, no more loopholes on compelling public interest. It should be clear that economic growth and job creation should not factor in compelling public interest. The failed promises of economic growth and more jobs in exchange for a health by industry have been long heard in our communities, and honestly, it has been failing us for a long time. If we're going to be protecting each of communities, we got to do it right. So I hope this feedback helps ensure that our communities are well informed and meaningfully participate. The law will stop the normalization of pollution in our communities and move us away from the legacy of pollution in the state. Thank you.
Thank you. Before you leave, would you mind just spelling your name for the song?
Chris, C-H-R-I-S, Tandazo, T-A-N-D-A-Z-O.
Thank you so much.
Good evening.
Yes.
Sorry to break that up over there.
we were just checking a couple of things.
My name is Aubrey Molinetto. A-U-B-R-E-Y-M-O-L-L-I-N as in Nancy, E-D as in David, O. I'm with Clean Water Action. I'm working on a grant in partnership with the Delaware River Networking Group and also funded by the William Penn Foundation. We do work surrounding the Assiniboine Creek in and around the city of Trenton and Mercer County. And we deal with the disproportionate groups of color in our communities. Last month, we had a listening session that had near to 100 participants from the Latino communities. And one of the complaints that we've heard and major concerns that we heard was that the communities are not getting the information that is needed in a timely fashion. And they don't understand the information that's given, and that's whether it's county, municipal, or state. This is a major concern. As you all know, the Latino population is one of the fastest growing populations in our nation as a whole, and especially in our urban communities. And it's very important that these communities receive the information. So my suggestion is not just to post it in the newspaper and to do the other mediums, which Chris, thank you very much for bringing up those other alternatives. My suggestion is to get in touch with the local houses of worship, the community organizations. We have one represented just off of my knowledge right here, Sherelle Snyder with East Trenton Collaborative. These are the people that are at the grassroots level that are doing the work in our communities before and after people such as myself leave. So it's very important that we engage them in the process so that they can have listening sessions and kind of just break down what it is that we're trying to articulate to them, whether it's through my organization or through the state or county municipal levels, right? A lot of people do not understand what the environmental injustices are in their neighborhoods on a academic level. However, they do know the results when their kids come out with autism, asthma, and other disproportionate illnesses and diseases that affect our communities predominantly because of these environmental injustices that are focused on our areas, because it seems like people don't care. But it's not that we don't care. It's that we're not educated and informed. And that's why folks such as myself will develop webinars to try to build toolboxes for our advocates in the community, and also so that our community can get in touch with what is really happening more than a surface level, right? So I hope that you take this into consideration and that you be more effective in this process. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
I don't mean to be greedy, but can I add something else?
Absolutely. As long as you sit down, you get a whole nother 3 minutes.
I sit down and I pick this up. Okay. So that's not the only demographic that needs help with understanding what's going on. The city of Trenton is very unique in the fact that we have a large Haitian population, we have a large Russian and Polish population, and we also have Liberians and Nigerians, and just the different classes and cultures in our community, right? And so we want to make sure that while we have those other mediums and vehicles to get the information out, that is broken down in a way in which they can understand. And these other cultures, they do have other associations that support them within their communities. They have their own banks a lot of times. They have their own legion halls and different things like that. So we want to make sure that we are touching base with all of those components, right? And not just solely focusing on African American or the Latino population, because these things affect them as well, because they're in the hub of our communities, and we don't want to leave anyone misrepresented or misinformed. And that's it. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Testify twice. Hi, it's Maria Lopez Nunez. Maria, M-A-R-I-A, and then it's Lopez Nunez, L-O-P-E-Z, dash N-U, Spanish N-E-Z. I figure there's not a lot of people here, but I feel like what just happened was pretty intimidating, right? And it's something that, you know, I do want to say on public record, as an advocate for environmental justice, I've had my house broken into, and I've been threatened and intimidated. So that I hope that when DEP is getting threatened or intimidated, that you can find moral courage to stand on the side of communities, to make sure that you hold everything that is strong about the law strong, and everything that is weak a little bit stronger, right? Because I can't imagine the opposition you might face, right? From industry, from politicians, people that want an economic exception. Economic exceptions that, quite frankly, have been the reason that we have environmental injustice in the first place. Racism only exists to serve capitalism, right? I won't get too theoretical here, but the reason that racism is there is to sacrifice our communities for profit so that people can make money. Yes, discrimination, all of that, but there's a greater purpose, and that's profit. And industry has shown its willingness to time and time again sacrifice communities of color and low-income communities, communities that have less political power. And so allowing any type of economic exception is just inviting in people to feed off desperation in our communities. We need economic viability just as much as anybody else. And I hope that unions at some point see that they should stop building things that hurt them too. Stop building things that might hurt their children, but maybe they don't live in our communities. And I know that there's health impacts as they build these things, right? That they might die younger in the promise of a job. And I think that what this law is about is the promise of a future, but only by stopping, you know, like we have to stop digging the hole. Because I don't think this law is the end all be all. It's just helping us stop what we've already been doing, right? It doesn't include renewals. So it's not gonna reverse the legacy of pollution that already exists. It only stands to stop bad things from coming in the future. And so I really feel strongly about that economic exception, about the compelling public interest. That language needs to be tighter. Right now it says for a primary environmental health or public safety, that needs to be further defined where people will try to slide in through that loophole. And at what cost? You have to, I don't know if it's an equation, but what is an environmental impact that can that actually, if you balance it out, is worth children's lungs and generations of children that are exposed to, let's say, another power plant when their neighborhood already has 4 power plants. I understand that sometimes we're trying to rectify one good, but it can never be rectified if we're doing it at the cost of human health. So I'll keep it there. I'll keep it under 3 minutes.
Thank you, Maria.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Melissa Miles, M-E-L-I-S-S-A-M-I-L-E-S, and I'm the Executive Director of the New Jersey Environmental Justice Alliance. Sure. Okay, so I have to follow on the heels of Maria, but you know, something that was just said kind of inspired me, which is, you know, part of the reason for this law is so that we can begin to have more of what matters to us and more of what is good for us in our communities. I don't think that this is a zero-sum situation where if we don't build more polluting facilities, that, you know, others will lose their jobs or not be able to continue their livelihoods. You know, we just want more of what's good, more of what's right, more of what's healthy, more of what's clean, more of what's educating. And so I think that by stopping, you know, putting a point on, you know, the permitting of polluting facilities in EJ communities opens the door for more creativity as well in what can be built in those communities that will serve those communities. And the law itself speaks to that in the permit conditions because, you know, first, I think it's important that we want to avoid additional pollution in communities that are designated as overburdened and where it can't be avoided completely, that it be minimized in that community. You know, we're not talking about offsets or projects in other places, which has happened in the past, but in that community, pollution should be avoided and minimized. You know, avoided when it's a new facility and minimized when it's a renewal. And overall, I think the best case scenario is when a facility is going to protect the community somehow. And I think that is the standard that we want to get to, is we build things in communities that are protective of those communities. I think also one thing that we have heard a lot about is public participation. One speaker mentioned that it's difficult to read a permit application. Sometimes they're hundreds of pages long. And even those of us who you know, are in this as a profession may talk with others who have the time and the capacity to read dozens or 100, you know, or more pages of a permit. So I'm really curious as to what can happen that will allow communities to actually get information, not just in the language they speak, but in the everyday common language that most people think in, so that they can really participate meaningfully when it comes to the permit hearing. Because unless there's education and significant education, I think it's going to be hard for regular people to actually participate in a meaningful way. So, you know, I would like to see, you know, more of that education in communities. And I will stop there because my time is up. Thanks.
Thank you, Melissa. Yes, sir.
David Pringle, I'm a consultant with Clean Water Action. I'm also on the steering committee of Empower New Jersey and on the Cranford Environmental Commission and also its green team. It's David, D-A-V-I-D, Pringle like the potato chip, P's and Peter, R-I-N-G-L-E. We are in strong support of this law and this proposed rule, and I'd like to highlight a direct quote from the legislature's findings and declaration when they pass this law in the opening sections of the act. The legislature further finds and declares that no community should bear a disproportionate share of the adverse environmental and public health consequences that accompany the state's economic growth. And that goes to the core, as Maria testified, and the incorrect concerns raised by a previous commenter. The definition of compelling public interest is tight. It could be even tighter, and it's very appropriate for it to be this way. Specifically, calling for the compelling public interest needs to primarily serve and be necessary to serve the essential health and safety of environment of folks in the overburdened community. That's not jobs and taxes. This law is needed because of jobs and taxes, because that has been an exclusion for well too often. And why does it matter? Let's talk about the city of Newark. Way too many other examples of overburdened communities, but I think it probably checks off more sources and types and size of pollution than any other. In the South and East Ward, you have the Port Authority, New York, New Jersey, and all the ships and trucks that come in around there. You got Newark Airport. You got Routes 1, 95, 78, 280. You have all the rail hubs. You have the garbage incinerator, at least three power stations. You have a dioxin-laden Superfund site, other Superfund sites, and dozens of other contaminated sites. You have the largest sewage treatment plant in the state. You have landfills, you have scrap metal facilities, and I've only scratched the surface, haven't I, of what's going on there. So it's screaming, you know, and vast majority of those, very, very few of those, probably none of them, would meet the definition of compelling public interest, yet they are in the city of Newark because they benefit other folks. This rule and this law are very reasonable. We would argue too reasonable. Given the history then, just in Newark that I've just quickly described, given the weakening amendments that were unfortunately done to the law as it was moving through the legislative process to get it, you know, through the legislature, maybe we wouldn't be able to get it through anyway if it was stronger, but, you know, we'll never know. But we'll go back to the legislature soon enough and get it stronger. But even in this rule, you can have a stressor that is horrible, but if not enough other stressors are equally horrible, they're not covered under this. So that's a concern. A couple areas we would like to see strengthened, and we'll be providing more detailed comments. I'll wrap up very quickly here. We'd like to see the notice go up well beyond 200 feet, especially a lot of these census tracts. You know, there isn't a lot of population, so 200 feet doesn't go very far. We think 1,000 foot for notice would be more appropriate. Also very much appreciate that where there are census tracts that have no population, you take a look at the adjoining census tracts. We would suggest you go a little further than that in low population census tracts. We think that would also be appropriate to see if there are overburdened communities in the adjoining census tracts. We don't have an exact definition or recommendation for you yet on where between zero and greater than zero you would consider that low population, but we'll get that to you, and we'll be providing more detailed comments during the written comment period and subsequent hearings. And let me just close by saying, you know, I heard somebody say that this is going to stop something that's vital, whether it be a school or a hospital or whatever. And I say vital to who? If it's so vital, it can fit the definition of compelling public interest if it's vital to that community. If it isn't, I'm sorry they're not here. Put it in your community. Thank you.
Hey.
Amen.
That's right.
Thank you. All right, it is 7 o'clock. We are going to close the record and end this public hearing. So thank you all for your engagement and your comments, and we will see you either in Camden, Newark, or online. Thank you all.
Thank you.